No Notes. What's up, everyone? How's everyone doing this cool but sunny afternoon in March? Hasn't this weather been crazy?
It has been.
It's
been
up, down, high, low, side to side.
You know, it's been a roller coaster ride, but I kind of like it. But I can deal with it. To me, it beats snow.
Oh, absolutely. Any day. Yeah. Even a little cold, but having the sun out and having some days where it's get a little taste of spring.
I know.
Is wonderful. You just gotta be, I guess, just be aware of how you're dressing. I mean, because you don't want to overdress, but then you don't want to underdress either, and then that's where it gets tricky.
But I tell you something else. I sort of get paranoid in a sense, because in the back of my mind, I'm saying to myself, when is Mother Nature gonna balance the books?
Yeah, absolutely. Because we still got to get through March, we got to get through April, and who knows what's going to happen then. And April is the trickiest month, because I never say we're out of the woods until May anyway.
Right.
So we'll see. But it's beautiful it day, cool, but and we're glad to be here. Guess what? No Notes is starting its seventh season.
Unbelievable.
Wow, man.
Unbelievable. Who would have thunk it?
I know.
Who would have thunk it?
I tell you, time flies when you're having fun. You know what they say?
They say time has wings.
And
it's 7 years.
It's flapping, right. Yeah, absolutely. So we're glad to be here. We're glad to have you here. We hope that everyone has the opportunity to tune in and talk and join the discussion, share your feedback on today's topic. Now, although it's not a complete 100 days for our new president, President Trump, we felt that we owed it to our audience to have a discussion about what's going on during these first 100 days. And it has been absolutely interesting.
It has been chaotic, in a word.
I tell you, I mean, from trying to establish the cabinet, to getting people in place, people resigning, our new president is trying to implement some new policies, trying to revamp some things. It's been less than 100 days, and it's just been, you know, your head is like you're watching a tennis match going back and forth. You know, what's going to happen next? So
you know, when I see how he operates, and I want to be, you know, condescending or whatever, but it just seemed like to me, like, he doesn't seem like he think things through. It seemed like it's sporadic.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, because it's really, it may be because he's just that businessman.
He's so impulsive. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's like if you say offend him or question something he does, he locks into that.
Yes.
He doesn't know how, you know, prioritize. Like, right. That's really trivial over there. You know, I have bigger fish to fry over here.
Right.
He gets caught up in petty things.
Right. Like. Right. And still has time to get on Twitter, which we'll talk about a little more.
Give you a prime example. He got locked into the inaugural crowd.
Right.
And he wanted to say that, oh, you know, the whoever took the picture, they left out this or they omitted that and whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. Who cares?
Right. Or things that are trivial and that are not as important that he's focused on. Right.
Here's the one I like. They were talking, he made a comment about, I think, having more electoral votes or whatever the case in history, whatever. And so he was called on the carpet, and they said, well, you know, Obama had, you know, X number, and I think George W. Bush, somebody had an X number, whatever. Mm-hmm. So in other words, what he was saying was untrue, that he had, you know, his more numbers than ever in history.
Electoral votes. Right.
And it wasn't true. You know what he said? Oh, well, that was the information that was given me. Come on.
So that brings us to our first, we're going to look at a few points, just a few. Some of the more, the real major points or the focus of his presidency thus far. And one really, before President Obama left, this one started, the investigation into the voting in terms of Russia's involvement. Were they involved? Were they not involved? Was there communications? Was there some tampering there? You know, that's still, that's really the first big thing and it's still being talked about, still on the table, it's still being looked at. But our I guess the question is, are we really going to get down to the nitty gritty and find out was there some type of involvement or did something happen here? And if so, what does that mean? It doesn't mean anything. You know, I don't know. But it's just interesting. I mean, it's interesting to think that another entity can have that type of influence on, and why would they want to tamper with the phony structure of that we know? You know, is enough of that as it is over the past years where, you know, voting has been questioned in terms of the voting machines being tampered with and you know, numbers being fixed on our end. But now you have this, which is huge. So does it mean if there's some evidence out there and if it's found, what does it mean for the state of the presidency? Is that going to change something? What's going to happen? What do you think?
Well, I think this is more of the sign of the times, you know, with, you know, technology, whatever the case may be. Mm-hmm. It's another form of Cold War. Mm-hmm. And because Russia seems to be, from what I read, that they tend to have been involved in other nations and countries.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and so this is nothing new to them.
Okay.
This is just they just decided to reach out to the United States. Okay. So this is something they've been doing to other countries. It seems like, from what I understand, it's an attack on democracy.
Mm-hmm.
And other countries that have a democracy society, mm-hmm. they have, you know, delved into their process as well. So mm-hmm. this is something that Russia has a history of doing.
Oh, okay.
It's like an attack on democracy.
It's real interesting. I mean, it's going now. I think the latest, there's more talk about how the FBI has handled, you know, their piece of the investigation and some questions there. So it's just continuous as they look into it, but it remains to be seen what if any evidence is going to be found, and if so, what is going to be the action? That I guess really that's what everybody's waiting to see. But our President Trump said he has had no communications with Russia. He has no special relationship with Russia. He's been saying that from day one, so
that's a prepared speech.
Right. We have to see how it turns out. So that's our first one. The second one is the travel ban, which has really been wow. What can you say to describe this? I mean, first of all, it's targeting seven Muslim countries. In particular, but the way it was introduced, I mean, it was just thrown out there. And then when it was thrown out there, it was chaotic because you had people traveling, you know, trying to come into the country. They're being told, oh no, you got it. As soon as they get here, you got to turn around, you got to go back. I mean, it was no introduction. It wasn't no explanation to it. It was just, here it is, and you know, you got to get out of here.
The implementation,
right.
That's where they went wrong. The implementation, they just came out of the blue. They blindsided you.
Right.
It's like, boom, here it is. Right. There was no thought. It seemed like there was no thought put into it. There was no, you know, smooth transition into it. It was just like, boom, here it is. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, suddenly you have this, you know. It wasn't thought through properly.
Not at all.
And the implementation was totally, they missed the point.
That's the question. What is the real thought process behind it? I mean, you know, from the administration, they're saying that this is being implemented to protect our way of life, to protect us. But it's really a stereotype. I mean, you're labeling a class of people as they're all the same, and for that reason they're not allowed here anymore. They're not able to come here. You got students that travel
right
from exactly. Here, travel over here, travel abroad. I mean, you know, it's so much. You got families that come. You got people that come to America because, quote unquote, to discover the American dream.
Right.
You know, the be able to have the opportunity to experience the freedoms that we have here. You know, what about those people, the innocent people? That you're just putting one label and saying this is it, and then you just throw this ban out, and now it was crazy. The airports were being jammed up. People as soon as they get off the plane, they were being told, "Oh no, you're not leaving the airport. Make plans, make arrangements to head back home." People that are trying to leave to come here, they were stopped. So now that was the initial. Now it's supposedly going to be reintroduced, a revamping of the travel ban, which it should be expected to come out within the coming weeks. We're in March now. We're waiting for that introduction, and so I guess we'll see how it's going to be executed this time.
Yeah, it's going to be very interesting in terms of, I mean, like you said, he's sort of like identified Muslims. It's like a religious discrimination, right, so to speak. But I sort of personally have mixed emotions about it, because from the standpoint that the times that we live in now, I can understand, and we're dealing with terrorists.
Right.
In order for terrorists to be effective, they have to be physically in your country.
Right.
So I can understand from that standpoint that you want to kind of control who's coming in your country.
Right.
And then the other side of that that makes it even more complicated is that you have United States citizens who have, you know, went online and bought into that concept, that philosophy.
Right.
So you have that issue you have to try to deal with. Plus, you're saying you're trying to control what's coming into the country. The reason why I say I have mixed emotions, because I can understand from the standpoint that
for safety reasons,
that, right, you know, you have to control who's coming into your country.
Right.
But there again, how you implement it is where I'm not sure what's the correct answer.
Right.
You know.
Right.
And that's where I think it gets real kind of shaky, you know.
Right.
Because you can't religiously, like, you're stopping people in the airport. You're a Muslim. You know, blah, blah, you know, that now you're pinpointing Muslims per se.
Right.
I don't know what the solution is. I just know that whatever his executive order was not properly thought through and wasn't properly implemented. But so, like I say, I understand what he's trying to do, and it's a very delicate situation. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean, he has to.
That's why it takes a lot of time.
A lot of thought. Yeah.
I mean, and definitely an introduction into, you know, this is the plan. This is why this plan is being, this policy is being put in place or being implemented. You know, give people are entitled to an explanation. So there's understanding and awareness as to why, what's behind this thought or this process, and then how we move forward in terms of executing it and putting it into full fold, and how is it going to work going forward. That's important.
It is.
So,
I was going to say it is, because the most important thing is that, you know, you don't want to profile people based on religion and race or whatever the case might be. Like I said before, you have a valid concern that you're trying to, you know, protect the people in terms of, you know, allowing a certain element to come into the country in terms of criminal or who may have bad intentions.
Right.
I don't know how you can monitor that.
Right.
You know, that's a very tricky, you know, situation. But
I mean, one way is just, you know, continue to enhance security. I mean, that's always ongoing. You know, the better that is, you know, then that's an area where it can be, of course, can be controlled properly, or you know, be as most effective as you can in terms of your security measures. But to do it, to just throw something out there like that, and it was just causing turmoil, you know, across the board, across the nation. You know, I mean, and so people are confused. People are, like you said, also mixed emotions about it. People are being hurt. People are being denied. They're traveling thousands of miles. They can't see their families. It was just wow. And so now we have to wait and see what the revamp is going to look like.
Hopefully
it's the revamp is a lot better executed, you know, and definitely explained and then executed this time around. And maybe will be more received and understood. you know, in terms of a security standpoint. Because really, I agree with you. Really, it is. I mean, it's looking at, you know, the security of it, the protecting of the nation, which is understandable.
Yeah, that's understandable. Right. I mean, you're trying to protect.
But the how you do it
exactly
is the question.
That's key. Yeah. Right. And that's a very delicate. Right. That's a very fine line you have to walk.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. So, point number three. This one, and I don't mean to laugh, but
sometimes you have to laugh to keep it crying. Right.
So, our president, President Trump, has taken a couple trips down to Mar-a-Lago, Florida. And excuse me if my pronunciation is a little off, but wow, the expense of these trips is just unbelievable. I mean, $11.1 million. I mean,
can you imagine what you could do with $11.1 million?
Wow.
Can you imagine the school system?
I mean, right. And to have, you know, his back and forth travels, he's having meetings, is there a reason why you can't have some of these meetings in the White House where you are? I mean, is it necessary to make a trip? I'm just trying to understand. I mean, wow, in less than a month, or about a month's time, that's your travel expense.
And he's almost there. This is almost like a weekly.
Yeah, man, because this week, it's been another trip. So, I mean, this is adding on to the $11.1 million. Here's another, I guess, higher. I mean, two trips, $11.1 million. Five, six, I don't know what it is. $4 or $5 million a trip. I mean, here's another adding on to the bill. I mean, look at all that has to be paid for. You got to pay for not only the travel, but Secret Service protection. You got to pay for the transport from the airport to the back and forth to the airport. Then you got the protection while they're down there. Then you got to pay for it to come back and secure airspace and all that costs money.
And they also transport his motorcade.
Right, exactly. You know, and then you gotta pay for everybody that's staying down there. Now last week there was a comparison made on the news, you know, where they were referring to the expenses put out for trips thus far by President Trump and what President Obama did, and it took him a year to do. Now, $12 million, a little over $12 million, but in the one year time frame, this is less than 30 days.
Yeah, that's mind-boggling.
So, what is this bill going to look like by the end of 2017? I'm scared. I'm scared to even think. If you could spend this type of money in about a month's time, or you know, 30 days or so, then what is it going to look like in 12 months?
Because part of that $11.1 million, I'm sure, is when once they arrive, they also the police department.
That's another piece. Absolutely. You got to prepare. They got to prepare for your arrival, and they have to take measures as well, you know, in conjunction. Although the Secret Service, you know, it trumps it. They're the full authority. I mean, but they got to prepare.
But still, the police do have to provide.
Oh yeah, because you're shutting down roadways. Yeah, yeah. You're shutting down the airport for forever long. You know, because they got to come in. Right.
You have to reimburse that city or whatever the case may be.
I guess we'll see. We'll continue to watch that and see how that unfolds.
But then also too. Mm-hmm. The other expense that they also seem like they're trumping up is the wife staying in New York in Trump Towers, and that's very difficult to secure because it's so open. Right. So that's another expense. You got to pay New York now for their police department because she's living in she's staying in Trump Towers,
and that's Secret Service protection and police protection.
There you go.
And dude, I guess I know during. Or right after the election, don't they? They had to barricade off with dump trucks and everything. I guess it's still some type of barricade set up there. I don't know.
I'm not really sure.
To the extent what it is now, but.
I'm not
well,
sure.
Maybe not, because he's President Trump's in Washington, and she's there, but still.
But she's there with their son.
Because
he's
going to school. Right, right,
exactly. So. But she still requires Secret Service.
Yeah.
And you still got to secure the building so people can. So exits and whatever else they do.
And anywhere she goes, or anywhere they go, that's another expense. That's added protection. Yeah. So it's interesting. It's going to be interesting to see what she does, what's her role, what active role she's going to play as the new first lady.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what is her passion, or what is she interested in? I don't know. In terms of making something better, or that's yet to be. I mean, I haven't heard anything.
No, I haven't heard
So that has yet to be seen.
The only thing that I've heard on the light side is that she made a decision to maintain Michelle's garden.
Oh.
No, Michelle had she grew vegetables, by the way.
Oh, that's
so she did
that's,
make a
that's so small.
She's gonna maintain that. Yeah. But as far as her career, what projects, what's gonna be her passion,
right?
That hasn't been determined.
I guess we'll see that. Yeah. You know, in the coming months to be continued.
Yeah.
Point number four, the wall, as I like to refer to it. So here we are. You know, the wall, which is supposed to separate Mexico from the United States, and our new president wants Mexico to foot the cost and build it. That's still on the table. And it's serious.
He's serious
about it. You know, he wants it done. Do you think is there a possibility of that happening?
You know what? At the price tag, they're talking billions of dollars.
Billions
to put that wall up. I don't know if the wall is the solution. You know, here again, I understand the security or the what you're trying to achieve. Mm-hmm. I understand that. But it seemed like to me you could do a better job of controlling the border than you've been doing.
Right.
Because obviously somebody, and I don't want to get too political,
right,
but it's obvious that they wanted these illegal immigrants to come into the country.
Right.
Because believe me, if they didn't want somebody at the top, if they didn't want them here, they would not be here in the numbers that they are here, in the millions. So obviously someone or some area, whatever the case may be, someone wants them here.
Right.
But it seemed like to me that it could be police better, maybe better manpower. I don't know if the wall is the solution, but you could protect the border better than what you're doing.
Right.
And like, again, I think this goes more to a political issue where
someone,
whether it's corporate America, maybe I shouldn't mention titles or whatever, but someone wants them here.
Right.
Because if they didn't, again, they would shut that down day one. You would not have millions and millions and millions of people coming, illegal immigrants coming into the country unless someone at the top want them here. And the other issue is that that they probably need to revisit the Constitution in terms of they keep talking about how the Hispanic community, and I'm not being racist or whatever, how they're population wise they seem to be increasing at a rapid pace.
Mm-hmm.
Well, if your policy or law says if a couple comes here and she gets pregnant and a child is born here, then they automatically got citizenship.
Right.
Of course we're going to try to impregnate our women so that we all now can be citizens.
Right.
You need to revisit that and see if something can be revisited or rethought that process where it shouldn't be where a person comes and gets pregnant and now we all citizens. It just seems like to me you could do a better job of enforcing.
Right, and marriage too.
But I'm saying you have an immigration law in place.
Mm-hmm.
From what I can see of it in the past, it was so strong. It took years from the time they filed for citizenship in their country to the time they physically got to the United States and they got sworn in. Sometimes they could take years. Now you could revisit that and try to streamline it so it wouldn't take such a long period of time.
Right.
But this thing about somebody coming to the country illegally and you say the dream, that's Obama's dream law, Dream Act, where if you stay out of trouble, then you automatically become a citizen. I don't think that should be the case. Other people have gotten in line, filed for citizenship, and they're waiting.
Right.
Anybody that was here illegally day one, they should have never allowed to get to the number that it is today.
Right.
It should have been day one. They should, they knew that was happening, send them back home. Mm-hmm. This thing about, oh, we don't break up families. Well, the reality is you have laws. Mm-hmm. When that person came into the country illegally, they broke up the family. Mm-hmm. It's not your responsibility. Case in point, give you an example. If I go rob a bank mm-hmm. to give my family a quality of life mm-hmm. or send my kids to college or get a better house and whatever the case may be, mm-hmm. are you going to say that because of my reason for robbing the bank, I'm not going to send you to prison but I'll break up the family? No.
Right.
You see
right.
what I'm saying? See my
right.
point?
Right, right.
When whoever decided to come to the country illegally, they broke up the family.
Right.
Because once they got caught or whoever, whatever, you breaking up the family.
Right.
It shouldn't be our responsibility. We have a law. We should enforce our laws. And
absolutely.
They weren't enforcing them. Again, because somebody
absolutely.
Wasn't here.
Right. And then what's the most, probably the most interesting piece of this, you want Mexico to foot the responsibility.
The president said good luck on that one.
100%. Right. I mean, yeah. so, right. This is something that you're introducing. This is the idea. This is something that you feel so strongly about in terms of security, protecting the nation. Then why do you feel that the United States doesn't have to have any responsibility to that other than telling Mexico, you're going to do this. I want you to do this. This is what you're going to do. I mean, that's...
I'm not sure how he can enforce that.
Because right, I mean, how?
Now, I do know that they said that the illegal immigrants that mm-hmm. are in the country, mm-hmm. that are working, that they send a certain portion of their income back to Mexico.
Okay.
And they say it tallies into the billions of dollars that mm-hmm. goes back to Mexico to their families and relatives back there.
Mm-hmm.
He was talking about, Trump was talking about doing a tariff on the incoming imports.
Oh, imports, right.
Yeah, put,
right.
put a tariff on that for, mm-hmm. I forgot what percentage. Mm-hmm. But by the same token, like Mexico said, well, then in that case, you won't pay, we can go tit for tat. So
right.
then we can charge tariffs for exports.
Right. The communication, it's just real choppy, I mean, and the expectation is even worse. I mean, so, again, here's something else that's on the table.
But you know what?
We're going to keep a close eye on it.
But you said something.
See how it unfolds.
You said something very important. Mm-hmm. He doesn't have a lot of, it doesn't seem to be like a lot of, you know, thought process. And
right,
and
it's just problem, my, the like problem. The man.
It's like a bully.
Right.
Like, oh, you going to pay for this.
Is that businessman mentality? Like, he coming in, going into a meeting, and you sitting down with your executives, and this is what I want done, and you guys are going to make sure it's done. That's it.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the approach.
It, right.
But as a president, I mean, as president, you
it's
can't,
a,
this
it's
is
a,
not.
It's a different beast.
Right.
It's a different beast.
You can't come in, you're referring to your company, and this is what you want executed right now. These business deals or whatever, business plans, and then boom, then get back to me when it's done. I mean, that's how it's being. So that's definitely.
So from that standpoint, it's almost like you're saying,
right.
like, he's in a different arena.
Yes.
So in terms of business world,
right.
and political.
But he's carrying his brain over
the business
mentality.
Concept
yeah. into the presidency, and that's where it's just.
It's like he put a thing on I think what he tweeted something about, oh, North America, they'll never get a nuclear weapon. Can't put
right.
Be
I mean,
more,
yeah.
be more tactful.
And why do you? And speaking of that, I mean, just before we get ready to go into point five, we got two
yeah.
more,
okay.
and then we're going to start wrapping up.
Okay.
But you're a president. How do you have time to get on social media so much?
Beyond
I mean, it's like immediate. It's like immediate. As soon as somebody says something that he feels like is outlandish, or he doesn't challenge him in any way, or he disagrees with it, he's right
regardless
on there.
Regardless of how minute.
He's right on there. I mean, and how do you got to run? You don't have time.
Exactly.
You got a country to run. You don't have time to be worried about who's saying something on Twitter. I mean, why are you concerned with that? What's going on there? When you got more pressing, way more pressing issues on your agenda that you need to work on, you need to address. Going back to the cabinet, your cabinet is not even in a full at full 100% capacity yet. I mean, because, you know, every time somebody's put in place, it seems like somebody's leaving. Right. Somebody's resigning. Exactly. Somebody's getting fired.
Exactly.
You know, so, but you got time to get on there and worry about it. Oh, what? You said this. What?
But you know, going back to
that's
the,
wild.
Going back to the cabinet point you brought up is very interesting, and also it kind of goes back to the, I don't want to be bouncing around, but sort of goes back to the Russian thing as well. In his cabinet, it's interesting how from day one, it's been known that that Trump has some affiliation with Russia.
Right.
To what degree,
Though he's saying,
but now
that's not the case. But
not yet,
right?
And his various cabinet members, Tillerson, he received an award, a Russian award, what's the award we have in the United States, the highest civilian award? I can't think of the title, but anyway, Tillerson received some sort of Russian acknowledgement or award. Civilian award. Mm. He had other people, various cabinet members that had ties. Flynn. Mm. But he's had four or five different cabinet members that have ties or some affiliation to Russia. Mm. This was like day one. And also, his son, last week I read an article where his son was talking about how back when they were having these bankruptcies.
Okay.
Trump's
companies. Right.
And how these Russian investors really bailed
some
them
type
out.
Of bailout.
Yeah, okay. They invested in the company.
Right. Okay.
And that's
the affiliation right there.
And that's the point they talk about compromising, uncompromising position, compromising position. Mm. That, and I think the son have said once before that it's been known that they have a major financial investment in the Trump industry. Mm. Isn't that kind of conflict?
Right.
Now they've known this. And then it, I guess it goes back to the tax returns too.
Why they can't be released?
He never released it,
and they're never going to be released. Probably at this point, I'm sure, because they haven't been done by now. Then,
so my point is, the point I'm trying to bring up is this Russian thing is not something that happened overnight.
Right.
They've known this from day one that Donald Trump had affiliations with Russia, going back from a business standpoint. That they're invested heavily invested in their company, because the son was saying that. At that time, when they were going through these bankruptcies and whatever, Wall Street wouldn't touch them in terms of loans and whatever the case may be. Russia came along.
Too much risk.
Bankruptcy after bankruptcy. So Russian investors came along and invested big money in the company, kept it afloat, and now look where they are today.
Right.
So they're sort of beholden to Russia from a business standpoint.
Sure. So we'll see. 5.5. Starting to look more into cutting federal aid in different areas of that. So it seems like it's early stages, but it seems like not everything that was implemented by the Obama administration, but it's going to be. That's going to be an area of focus, too, to try to eliminate or overturn or revamp some things quite a few things that have been put in place, by the Obama administration. So that just this week is really starting, where I've seen it starting to unfold in terms of trying to do some changes and some cuts. And a little bit about starting to talk about healthcare reform. And what's going to happen there. Of course, you can't just eliminate it. You can't just say, this plan, because even before he was officially elected, during the debates, it was President Trump spoke to, you know, it just needs to change. It is not right the way it is now, and I'm gonna just put that. We're just gonna throw that out, and then we just gonna introduce something. You can't do it. It's not that simple. You just gonna take this and just say, oh, toss. I mean, without having something already ready to go, it has to be a rollover of some type. I mean, you can't just say this just doesn't work. Just I don't like out. It. Just throw it out. Okay. I mean, so now that's really scary, I think, because it's little talk right now, it was more on the table when during the debates and that type of discussion. But now, I guess here's something else with that. We have to wait to see how's it going. I mean, what is the plan? I mean, can you get into that a little more? You know, what is it? Okay, you feel like there's a better way.
They talk.
So let's talk. I mean, why don't you start letting the public know? You know what? So what are you talking about here? What do you mean there's a better way? How's it going to be?
They never. You know, the reality was they never had it. They never had a replacement. They talking about repeal and replace.
Repeal and replace.
But the problem
right?
was when Obama was in office, everything was obstructionist. Right. Whatever he suggested,
No.
So they never said no, and here's the replacement or here's the alternative to that. And just like now also, Trump is talking about this infrastructure bill going, and they all up and everybody's so happy and perky. Well, when Obama introduced the infrastructure bill, no.
Yeah, right.
It's like, no. Now today is the greatest. Oh, it's so great. It's going to create jobs. It's going this. It's going that. Well, but see, at that time, Congress was more of an obstructionist. Mm-hmm. It didn't matter how good it was or how effective
it was. It was just because
he introduced it. No. Right.
No.
Because Romney, when he was in Massachusetts as a governor, whatever he was in Massachusetts, he introduced a health bill that
similar to
right. Obama, and he said he was quoted on TV in an interview saying that it should be national.
Right.
But when Obama introduced it,
right.
No. But now going back to coming up to the present day, Boehner, the retired House Speaker that Paul Ryan replaced,
right.
Republican, he said it's all a con game. As far as this, you know, replacing Obamacare, right. repealing all that.
Right.
He said because his rationale is that the time for that to have happened, when it realistically could have happened,
when it
was in 2012. No, it was in 2012.
Okay. Okay.
Had they won the election in 2012, the Republicans, then they could have done. Okay. Then they could have, you know, replaced it, repealed or whatever.
Right.
He said, but now it's we got too many people. It's in effect now.
Right.
You got people on it. People relying on that insurance.
Right.
And
millions.
And he said millions. Yeah.
Right.
People they are now relying on that, like Social Security.
Right.
And he was saying that the healthcare industry itself, their budget or numbers are based around that now. So it's embedded now. So that's why he's saying now
really,
all the stuff they're talking now about this. He said, like, it's almost impossible to repeal it or replace it now. Mm-hmm. 2012, like he said, 2012, he could have done that. Because at that time, it wasn't in effect. It was just a theory. I mean, they're working on it and they're implementing it. But now you got people that are on affordable health care. Mm-hmm. They rely on it. You know, so he says all con game
right.
on it. So I'm waiting to say. And he's Republican.
Definitely. So, yeah, right. And that's interesting. Yeah, from the Republican side.
He's retired,
right?
I'm saying.
Right. You know, so.
Well, he said, you know.
So that's just six major points within the first 100 days of we thought were really valid points to speak to and to see all still on the table. Where is it going next? I know the world is waiting to see. So. It shall be interesting as
that's the scary part.
The first 100 days unfolds. And just to add one more thing real quick, the other thing that I thought was interesting, you mentioned all news is fake. First it started with CNN, I think initially, where he said, no, you're is it a press conference? You're fake news. No, I'm not answering that question. Now's everybody. Now's everybody. Because he's putting out, you can't get mad with news and you putting out wrong information. You know, that's on you. You need the people, again, going back to your cabinet. What type of research are they doing? I mean, they feeding you this information and you're presenting this information. And so it comes out as inaccurate or old or not relevant.
Or in a word, a lie.
Right. Then you want to turn around and say, you're not from that going forward, what are you not going to hold press conferences now when the news is going to be about? I mean, what you going to do? I mean, because since everybody's fake now, I mean,
But see, when they tell something that turns out to be, and they have a history of this, they'll make statements and make comments that people will later on investigate and come back and say that's not true.
Right.
They don't consider themselves lying. They call it alternative facts. Okay. Never heard of alternative. That's what they call when I say something is not true.
Right.
I'm not lying. It's alternative facts. Okay.
So is that piece of me seeing too. So we're going to continue to follow this.
Alternative facts.
After we get past, I think what we'll do is we'll come back after the first 100 days is officially over, and then see where we are on some of these points, or has anything been changed, or is it still where it, I don't know. We're not going to say that. Who knows?
You can't project with this administration.
You can't project. Right. Yeah, absolutely.
There's no rhyme or reason to
it. Right. You know, because it's going up, down, side to side. Yeah. You know, who's going to be leaving? Who's going to be replaced?
He may have a whole new cabinet.
I know.
He's
struggling to get the hold on to what he got. I mean, I think this is the first time that I'm aware of, you know, in my lifetime, where I see the administration itself is such a challenge to put it together.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's been some real challenges. It's been difficult. So we'll see. But before we go, that was our talk about the first 100 days. Again, we'll revisit that at a later time to see where we are after the 100 days is over. But I just want to talk about sports a little bit real fast.
Okay.
In particular, our home team, the Sixers. I was hurt to hear that Embiid is out for the season because of his injury.
I was devastated too.
Yeah, man, because the Sixers were on rock. I mean, it was just, you know, today on the 4th last year, the Sixers only had won 9 games. Then now they're 23. It just because they won last night.
Yeah.
Which is great against the New York Knicks. They beat them.
Yeah.
So, but, I mean, you can see, I mean, it, 23-38 is their record now. I mean, okay, it's not a wild win.
It's fantastic.
But look at, you can see the transition from 9 games, only winning 9 games up until this point in March of 2016, same day, March 4th. And now they have 23 games on it, but I mean that's commendable. I think, just watching him play, man. I mean he's just an energized player. I mean he's helping bring life to the team. You know it's great. I just hate to hear that he'll be out for the rest of the season. But I hope wish him well recovery, recovery, and he'll be ready for next season. But what I mean. As if that was bad enough, then you go and trade Noel.
Yeah.
I mean, what's up with that? I mean,
I've read a couple articles where it seems like they're asking this the sports fans and whomever else involved in sports seem to be asking for the president of basketball operations, Colangelo. He's making all the decisions. They're now saying they want him out.
Wow.
I mean, these are the fans, and I'm not saying that the organization.
Yeah, because that doesn't make sense.
Everybody's saying the same right. thing. Because Noel, why would you
choose him? I mean, here we are again, another quality player. Now we already know what's going to happen. He's going to go somewhere else, and he's going to blow up. And then we're going to be the fan, you know, everybody going to be back here saying, like, dang. Because it's happened every time. Every time we have let somebody, a caliber, quality player go, they have gone somewhere and have just been excellent.
Corver, Lou Williams.
I just don't understand this. So for the trade, here we are. It makes me feel like we're going back to, no offense against Bynum. But we got Bynum, and he came to us injured, and there was no
damaged goods.
Right, no productivity there. Here we are again. You got a first round draft pick, but you also taking on another injured player. What's? I mean, what? what does that mean? I mean, what, you know, and you let a good player go. I mean, and then again, if somebody had, you know, whatever you're trying to do, trying to build up the bank again, because I mean, to us from last year's, you know, strategy in terms of building up your revenue. I mean,
he did say
you shouldn't need.
He did say years,
right?
It's been 3 years, right? Man.
I mean, you shouldn't need how much money. How much more money do you need in the organization? I mean, what? I'm just lost.
But see, what was interesting going into this year? They were saying, yeah, the previous 3 years, it's really about
building
the bottom line.
Bottom line. Yeah,
you know, sure. How much net, you know.
Right.
So they said this year going forward is about winning.
Right.
Well, getting rid of Noel is not showing me you're trying to win per se. Yeah. So, but here's the rationale that was given was that. You know, you have a number of contracts coming up next year that people are going to get their first big contract.
Right.
Noel was one. I think Embiid is going to be due. Covington is going to be due for. So they got big contracts, but you got the money to pay them.
Right. So what is the problem? What is the problem? And let them stay here. And let them rebuild.
You develop them,
right?
You develop. Now you gotta walk,
right? And then exactly. So when I don't know. I mean,
I'm befuddled.
It's gotta be frustrating for the players themselves too. I mean, because it's like, you know, people that come here to Philadelphia, they want to play here. Some even to the point they want to play here and just play out their full career and retire here. I mean, so. I don't understand, but he's gone now. So I guess nothing else you can say. But
if there's any consolation to you, I was watching the game last night, and the individual that was traded for, I think his name is Justin Anderson or something. He's gonna be nice. He's going to be an asset.
Okay.
He's a young player, defensive, you know, but still, man, I still can't get over Noel. Right. I mean,
I was going to say something, but I'm not going to say it. But we just wanted to comment on that. I mean, you know, with Noel, we wish you the best.
Yeah.
And B, we wish you a full recovery. Absolutely. I mean, we think we're great. A great player, but
charisma.
Team responds to him. I know he's feeling the pain too. You know, he
and
can't.
Ben Simmons.
So we'll see what happens. You know, but again, this time last year, I mean, still a big transition.
Yeah, but you can only take so much this emotional roller coaster.
Right. Yeah.
It's like you're all over the place, right? Up and down the side. Right. You know? I mean, you like to have some kind of stability for a few years anyway.
Right. Yeah. So hopefully we can get to that. I mean, because it is, I mean, after, like you say, it's been 3 years. Mm-hmm. Now this year,
and
2016, 2017 season, it's a winning, it's supposed to be a winning year, but I don't know, this is a curveball. Right now, so we'll see, but more to come on sports. I mean, we're gonna have the draft going to switch channels.
Yeah.
The NFL draft is coming here, so that's gonna be nice.
And you know,
yeah,
I was looking at, I saw something. They was showing some projections of how they're gonna do this outside. I think the Parkway is gonna be involved somehow.
Okay,
but it's gonna be like an outside. It's gonna be something very new and very creative.
Okay,
it's something very, you know.
That's huge.
Somehow it's going. The Parkway is going to be.
They're going to choose the Parkway.
Yeah, somehow.
So they're not going to have it down.
No,
in South.
I didn't get all the details, but they were showing, you know, some premature little things that they have in mind.
Oh,
and they're going to take it to another level. It's not going to be like in a building per se.
Interesting.
And maybe at some point we will, but somehow they're going to incorporate the Parkway and decorate. You know, it's going to be a big. To do. Mm. It's going to be very interesting.
Looking forward to that. Absolutely. Yeah. So that about does it for us for our season premiere of our seventh season, episode 130. We thank you for joining us. Oh man, blessings, man. It's great to be here. For everyone that supports us, we hope that you continue to do so. We hope that you, of course, enjoyed this episode. Many more to come throughout the year this year. And we're going to make it fun. We hope to introduce, or we definitely plan to introduce some new things along the way, some events that we have coming up. So we'll keep everybody posted, you know, and thanks for, again, thanks for joining us.
And there's nothing wrong with some a little oldie but goodies.
Yeah, absolutely.
Like,
absolutely.
Antoine Gay.
Oh yeah, yeah, absolutely, absolutely. We definitely we started a special segment on violence, preventing violence that we started at the end of the year of 2016. So we did, Anthony is definitely going to be. Antoine Gay is definitely going to be back with us, and maybe some more because we like to revisit some people that we also visited with earlier last year. To see how they're doing this year in terms of business and what's new
and their
with
pursuits,
them.
Yeah.
And their pursuits, like Erica, for one.
Yeah.
Hopefully,
one
person we definitely hope to get in that we didn't have an opportunity to do so is Michelle Snow. We hope to have her on.
Yeah.
But we'll definitely, as always, keep everyone posted. Again, thank you for the support. Thank you for the love. And welcome to the new season of No Notes. We welcome your feedback and hope to hear from you about that. And as we move forward to make this thing better,
are they signing in for us on the?
Oh yeah. I mean, we get a lot of love. Okay, good, you know, we good, see good. It. You know, we see it all the time. Yeah, so okay. You know, continue that.
Okay.
And especially when we're live, like right now, you know, hit us up. You know, that definitely. So without further ado, we're gonna say adios. You want to close us out?
We'd like to wish you peace, love, and soul. Have a brown weekend.
Take care now. Enjoy the rest of this weekend. Peace.